basics how I do it.
So good afternoon, everybody, again. And again, thank you for the invitation. It's really a pleasure for me to be with you and to give this lecture on flexible ureteroscopy or retrograde intrarenal surgery. And I will mix of three topics. I need to give the talk on the basics, the good settings for laser, and also regarding ureteral access sheath. So it will be just one presentation to combine the three topics. That's my conflict of interest. I'm a regular consultant for these companies. And as you know, all of them are developing endoscopic instruments. I would like just to start and to remember you, these three gentlemen. I'm sure that you know all of them very well. Christian Chaussy, very well known for shockwave lithotripsy. Peter Alken, who developed the Alken dilators for PCNL. And Dr. Perez Castron, who is actually my favorite one, since he worked a lot in ureteroscopy, and that's a picture that I really like to present all the time. That's the original picture when Dr. Perez Castro, together with Dr. Martinez Spinero, together they perform the first therapeutic intrarenal surgery using a regular cystoscope to remove a stone from the kidney. I like also to remember these two gentlemen, Dr. Bagley, Dr. Grasso, as you know from the United States. They were maybe not the first to perform flexible ureteroscopy, intrarenal surgery, but they are really two main pioneers in this field. Also, to have a look into the guidelines and to realize that in the last 10 years, so it's a relatively short period of time. If you look at the evolution of the guidelines, it's relatively, I would say, spectacular. Of course, for stone more than 2 centimeters, we still have to recommend PCNL. And this is the gold standard until now. Even flexible ureteroscopy is sometimes possible with specific conditions, of course, but flexible is coming actually also for these big stones, more than 2 centimeters. For stone between 1 and 2 centimeters, if you are back in 2010, shockwave lithotripsy was really the standard treatment. And you see that now endourology directly competes with shockwave. So it means that there is no need actually to do shockwave lithotripsy first. We can immediately discuss with the patient flexible ureteroscopy or PCNL. And of course, PCNL, because we develop in the same period of time the mini PCNL. And mini PCNL, as we have seen this morning, for few patients, it's an excellent technique also for these medium size stones. For stone less than 1 centimeter, again, flexible ureteroscopy directly compete with shockwave lithotripsy. For ureteral stone, since few years now, ureteroscopy also competes with shockwave lithotripsy, and for some specific stones and specific location, ureteroscopy is even superior to shockwave lithotripsy. So as you can see, in the last 10 years, the guidelines completely change. If we compare the European guidelines with the American guidelines, it's interesting to see that both societies are looking at the same publications, but they are not producing exactly the same recommendations. For the European, for kidney stone, we exclude the lower pole, we are more considering the size of the stone. And as we mentioned before, for the mid size, 1-2 centimeters, It could be shockwave or flexible ureteroscopy or PCNL. So you can discuss the three techniques at the same level. For the Americans, they still consider the limit of 2 centimeters. If it's more than 2, PCNL is the gold standard. If it's less than 2, you are supposed to discuss shockwave or flexible ureteroscopy. They are not discussing PCNL for stone less than 2 for the first option. And it comes probably because, as you know, the Americans, they are not performing mini PCNL at present time. They are starting to do it, but in the last years, they were not performing really mini PCNL. For lower pulse stone, again, the European, they are more looking about the anatomy, and if the anatomy is relatively simple, shockwave lithotripsy is fine, otherwise endo-urology. For the Americans, they are more looking about the stone volume, the stone size. And for ureteral stones, we said before, for the European, a stone less than 1 centimeter, it could be shockwave or ureteroscopy. More than 1, ureteroscopy is the first. For the Americans, even the stone is smaller, ureteroscopy is always the first option. So now, talking about retrograde intrarenal surgery, I think this is a very simple message, probably, for most of you. But when we are talking to the beginners, the young residents, I think it's always nice to remember them, the anatomy, and just two very simple messages. The first one is the ureter is not straight. As you know, when we are in the OR, the patient is in the lithotomy position in front of us, and when we inject contrast, that's the picture. It means that the ureter is completely horizontal and straight. And of course, we know that this is not the real situation. When we do a ureteroscopy going through the urethra, as you know, we have to go down in the bladder, we have to engage the ureteral orifice, come up to the iliac vessels, and this is actually the most highest point, this is the top, and then we go down into the kidney with the posterior calyces and the anterior calyces. So that's the first message, that the ureter is not straight. We have a lot of curves and we will have to negotiate. And it's easy to understand that for the distal ureter, the semi-rigid or the rigid ureteroscope, a good equipment, but since we have to pass the iliac vessels, most of the time, flexible ureteroscope are much easier to manipulate. The second message is, of course, the size. Always keep in mind that the diameter of the ureter is more or less 10 French. And I would even say, because I operate few patients in India, I would say that even in India, the size of the ureter is much smaller. And sometimes when I discuss with my American colleagues, I always told them that the American ureter is much larger than the Indian one, for example. So we cannot give exactly the same recommendations when we are working in the States compared to India, in terms of pre-stenting, in terms of size of the instruments we will use, and for example, the size of ureteral access sheath. Sometimes it's easy to place a big sheath, but in my experience, again, in India, I would say that placing a 12-14 access sheath systematically, it's almost impossible due to the size of the ureter. So we need all the time to keep this. When we do these procedures, before, we need to be sure that the urine culture is negative. I know that in some countries in the world, some people, they don't check the urine culture before doing a ureteroscopy. I think it's much safer to be sure that the urine culture is negative. If it's positive, you just have to treat the patient with antibiotics, just confirm it's negative after the treatment, and then you can go for the procedure. We use the regular lithotomy position, so nothing very special, relatively easy for all the patients, the same position. For the anesthesia, you can discuss spinal or general anesthesia, but we more recommend general anesthesia, and I will mention why, X-ray control. We can see actually more and more people who recommend to do ureteroscopy without X-ray, saying that it's a completely feasible with no X-ray control. I agree, it's possible, it's feasible, but I'm not sure that's what we need to recommend. The message is a little bit different. I think that you must have X-ray in the operating theater, but you need to reduce the use, you need to optimize the use of X-ray. But I don't think that we can recommend, especially to the beginners actually, to do this technique without. The patient should be informed, of course, and according to the recommendations in new country, you have to discuss antibiotic prophylaxis. When you are doing this procedure, it's time consuming. It's not a very quick procedure. You will have to spend time. So it's essential to think about the ergonomic of the room, to be very comfortable during all the treatments. That's the position I like to use, actually. My patient is in the regular lithotomy position. I put my video screen in front of me with the radiological screens. The X-ray is coming from the left. I'm in between, and I just rotate a little bit. I'm not facing the patient. This is not so comfortable, and it's a bit complicated to manipulate the endoscope. So the best position is to be a little bit like my assistant on this picture. So you take some lateral position. Anesthesia, we said before, the best is general anesthesia. Why? Because of this situation. What you can see on the left is the kidney, and the kidney is moving. Why? This is not because the surgeon is moving, but just because the patient breathes. And since the patient breathes, the kidney is moving up and down. And it's really difficult to maintain the good position, to compensate this movement. Sometimes it's possible because the movement is relatively limited, but most of the time it's difficult. And if you activate the laser when the kidney is moving, sometimes you will damage the mucosa. And then it bleeds and it becomes more complicated. So you need to fix these movements. And the best way to do it is to ask the anesthetist to stop the machine. If he ventilates the patient for some time, then he will be able to stop the machine for a few minutes. And then he restarts and he stops again and again and again. Doing that, you will have a period of time with no movements, and then you can proceed. And when the anesthetist ventilates again the patient, then you can irrigate to clean the dust, and when it stops, you can restart. And this is a very easy trick. You just need to communicate with the anesthetist. The endoscopes, we will talk tomorrow about the differences between the endoscopes, but the main difference actually is the fiber optic and the digital for the quality of the view. Another very common difference in terms of endoscopes, that's the European and the American mods. As you know, both mods exist with the different companies, and we cannot recommend one mod or another one. As a European, I'm using the European mod, that's the one I like, but again, I cannot tell you that there is benefit using the European or the American one. It's up to you. Regarding the manipulation, also coming to the anatomy, never forget, if the patient is in front of us, imagine this is the patient with the right kidney and the left kidney, the patient is in the lithotomy position. When we are into the right kidney, that's the endoscopic vision. This is the pelvis. These are the calyces. And the calyces in the right kidney are coming from the left side. It means at 9 o'clock. To move the endoscope at 9 o'clock, the movement is this one. You need to move your hand in supine position. Doing that, the scope is going at 9 o'clock. For the left kidney, that's just the opposite. The calyces are coming from the right. To go at 3 o'clock, you need to move in prone position. And it's easy to remember. If you are right hand, like myself, it's much more comfortable to treat stones in the left kidney, because this position is not really painful. This one is more painful after some time. Another comment regarding the manipulation of the scalp. As you know, if you would like to move in supine and prone position from 3 to 9 o'clock, you have to rotate, as we said just before. But there is also the possibility to rotate the scalp using this movement. And this movement, we call it the micro-rotation, is a very precise movement. So when you would like to move a little bit into the kidney, we much more recommend to use this movement. The left hand is supposed to push and to remove the scalp to do this movement, but at the same time, you can also rotate. And doing that, you produce a very small torque, and it's really, really beneficial. When we place the laser fiber, we have all the time the same discussion. Where do you have to stop the position of the fiber? This is just a recommendation to be safe regarding the endoscope. It means that the tip is not too close from the tip of the endoscope, but also not too far. If you push too much the fiber, the vision will not be so good because the irrigation will not be good. So when you are placing the tip of the fiber, that's what we recommend. You consider the midline and you put the tip just in between. So it means 1/4 of the diameter. This is the best position actually, not too far and not too close. Working channel 3.6, charrière, or French. So it means 1.2 millimeter. You need to know, and we mentioned this morning, some endoscopes present the working channel at 9 o'clock and different one at 3 o'clock. Is it important or not? The answer is yes, it's important. And we have seen this morning the situation. If you would like to remember that, you need to know that if you are using a 9 o'clock position, like this morning with Olympus, the 9 o'clock position is actually the best position when you are working in the left kidney with the stone in the posterior calyces. But if you are working in the right kidney and the stones are located into the anterior calyces, this is also 9 o'clock. And for the 3 o'clock, that's of course the opposite. Something very easy to know, looking at the CT scan, you can see where is the stone, left, right kidney, if it's anterior or posterior. And looking at that, you can select the best equipment with the 9 or the 3 o'clock position. It depends, of course, of your equipment. Irrigation, we have discussed also irrigation, and I think it's essential to maintain low pressure into the kidney. So to maintain low pressure, you need to use a low pressure to irrigate. What we recommend to use no more than 40 centimeters. If you're using 40 centimeters, you will get at the maximum 40 centimeters into the kidney. If you remember that the pressure of the renal colic is more or less 80, 100 centimeters, if you fix 40, you are really below the pressure of the renal colic. 40 centimeters of pressure, using 3.6 charrière, it means 40 milliliters per minute in terms of irrigation. It's largely enough if you would like to make a diagnostic procedure, just to have a look. The flow is absolutely acceptable. When we are into the kidney, this is the initial view. You see the collecting system, but it's full of blood. urine, some debris. What can you do? You can aspirate the collecting system and then you irrigate again. But if you do it very gently. Don't aspirate too fast, otherwise you collapse the system and it will bleed. And if it's bleeding, it's more and more difficult. So if you like to aspirate, you can do it, but do it very gently. I would say the safest recommendation is don't aspirate, just irrigate. You can take a syringe and you just push into the working channel 1, 2, 3 times the syringe. And doing that, after 2 minutes, you completely evacuate the blood and the urine. And after 2 minutes, the vision should be like this. There is no reason to have bleeding at the beginning of the procedure. So you should all the time work with this initial vision. To obtain this, take your time and just irrigate for a few minutes. Remember that the problem with hyper intrarenal pressure, if you force irrigation into the kidney, you will generate high pressure into the kidney. And high pressure is the main factor to generate complications. Bleeding, hematoma into the kidney or around the kidney, urinoma, pain, and of course, the worst, the sepsis. If the urine are infected, if you produce high pressure, you will produce this intrarenal reflux with infected urine, and that's the main problem actually associated with sepsis. So the question is, okay, but which technique should we recommend to irrigate? Should we ask the nurse? Should we use this pressure cuff, manual pump, or gravity plus manual pump, automat pump? What is the best system today? Nobody knows exactly which is the best system. What we know actually is when we are using this kind of system, we know that we produce really high pressure into the kidney. And we have no control actually when we are pressing the bag or if we are using this pressure cuff. So we don't recommend to use this. We prefer to fix some pressure, 40 centimeters, and use such kind of system, even a very simple syringe, just to increase the flow when you need it. If you need an additional extra flow, you can maintain using this kind of manual pump. And it's absolutely necessary because when you insert instruments into the working channel, you see that the flow is limited. So to compensate, it's always good to have such kind of instruments, but don't force. If you force the system, you will generate this picture. And you know what does it mean? It means extravasation. Why? Just because by increasing the pressure, you produce what we call the fornix rupture. You know the fornix? The fornix is this white line making the junction between the papilla and the collecting system, but it's very fragile. So if you produce high pressure, you crack the fornix and then you generate extravasation. Just to show you this in real life, this is the fornix. My assistant is forcing too much and you see you crack. It's not a big damage, I would say. It's like a renal colic, okay? The problem is, first, it bleeds immediately because the fornix is full of small vessels, very fragile. So it bleeds and then the vision is not nice. And of course, the second problem, if you are treating infected stone, then you will generate more infection, sepsis. So the message is simple, never force irrigation. The problem is to know how much you can force, and it's very subjective. We have no possibility actually to control the pressure. We are missing actually pressure sensor that we can leave into the kidney to know the pressure, to adapt the irrigation. It will come very soon, and when we will get this sensor, it will be much easier to control the pressure. Just to show you, We start with 50 centimeters of pressure. And look, my assistant manipulates this kind of pump. Using 5 times, he reached 1 meter of pressure. And now it's 150. Now he stops. The pressure is coming back to the basic pressure, 50 centimeters. And now he's forcing. 2 times, 1 meter. 4 times, 150. And now he forces, and it's 220. 2 meters 20 in few seconds. Okay. 2 meters 20 means that the patient is under the table and the irrigation bag is 2 meters higher than the patient. It's really high pressure. That's what we do if we are forcing this kind of system. So those systems are really efficient, but you need to manipulate very gently. We confirm that. We also confirm that if you are using an assistant like this guy, you will probably have some problems. So you need to be really, really gentle. In terms of irrigation, if it's bleeding too much and you don't see clearly the stone, you don't see really the urothelial tumor, what you can do is to inject contrast. You fill the system with contrast. If you do that, the contrast, as you know, because of the density of the contrast, will separate the blood, and the blood will go to the top into the anterior calyces. And then it's much easier to localize the stone in this transparent liquid. For the access, we recommend to use, of course, wires, and I would say any kind of wire, the one that you like. The recommendation is to use the stiff one. Never use soft wire because it's very difficult to backload the flexible scalp or ureteral access sheath using soft one. So stiff wire are actually the best. And also remember that this number, 0.038, the unit is inch, and it means 1 millimeter. So it's very useful to use to the safety wire into the collecting system to evaluate the size of the fragments. This is the stiff wire. If you like this hydrophilic one, the terumo-like wire, to recognize the stiff, it's really easy because this plastic tube is always blue if it's a stiff one. If it's transparent like this, this is the soft, the regular one. We don't recommend this one. We recommend this blue one. Do we need a safety wire or not? As you know, it's still a debate all the time. That's usually what I say to illustrate. It's a philosophy to use a safety wire every day because most of the time you will never use it as a safety wire, but maybe 1 or 2 times every year you will need the safety wire and then you will be happy to use it. So this is a personal decision. It's up to you. I don't think that you will increase the morbidity because you are using a safety wire, but again, you can regret sometimes not placing a safety wire. So definitely it's up to you. A good combination is to use also angle tip catheter in combination with the wire. It could be straight or angle tip again. And if you combine these two instruments, you can manage most of the time all the directions of the ureter. Another endoscopic vision, when you are placing a stiff wire and when you advance the wire into the kidney, you see I push my wire, and because it's a stiff one, rigid, you open largely the ureter. If you see this, you can try to place an ureteral access sheath, a small one, 10-12, usually it fits. But if it's this vision, when you push the stiff wire, you are not able to open the ureteral orifice. Most of the time, the ureteral access sheath will not fit. You will have maybe to use the balloon to dilate the ureter, but most of the time you will not be able to do it. So when you see this, I would recommend don't open an ureteral access sheath because it costs. And if you cannot use it, it's a pity. But consider maybe to pre-stent the patient, or you can also decide to do the surgery without an ureteral access sheet. It's completely feasible without. Today, we don't recommend to pre-stent systematically patients or to balloon systematically all the ureters. You need to balloon if you have really a stenosis. Otherwise, there's no need to do it systematically. How to perform the no-touch technique? It's a different access into the ureter. I mean how to engage directly the ureteral orifice with no ureteral access sheath and with no wire in place. When do you need to do that? For example, if you have to do a diagnostic procedure, you would like to go into the system with no trauma of the system because of the wire or the access sheath. The sequence is the following. First, you need to rotate to see the ureteral orifice. You see the left, and then you see the right. When you see the orifice, then you deflect to place the orifice in the center of the screen. When it's into the center, you push. You advance the scalp to engage. So remember the sequence. First, you rotate to see, then you deflect to place the orifice in the center, and then you push. Doing that, you will engage directly the ureter. This is not really difficult to do. I would not recommend to do this technique if you have no experience, but very quickly, you can learn how to do it. False passage, as you know this situation. You try to place a wire, and immediately, you perforate. And if you inject some contrast, you see the extravasation. That's what we call the false passage. Again, you need to remember the anatomy, knowing that the ureter is coming from down, up to down, and is coming from external to internal. It's not completely straight, again. So if you remember that, you know that the ureteral lumen usually is in this part of the orifice. If you go like this, I mean down and internal, you will perforate. This is most of the time the location for the false passage. Because when we are placing the wire, we go directly in this location and then we perforate. It's of course the opposite for the left ureteral orifice. The ureteral lumen is more located between 12 and 2 o'clock. And if you perforate, you will perforate in this part between 6 to 9. So knowing that, you can engage the false passage. You come back very slowly, very gently. And when you see the flap of the mucosa, you can direct the wire on the opposite direction. That's the way to replace the wire when you produce a false passage. Ureteral access, today, few advantages are really demonstrated associated with ureteral access sheath. But it's clearly demonstrated that you maintain low intrarenal pressure by using an ureteral access sheath because you facilitate irrigation. Many years ago, people were thinking that an ureteral access will produce all these benefits. If we look today the publications, what is clearly demonstrated, facilitate multiple entries and exits. It seems easy to understand. So facilitate irrigation and maintain low intrarenal pressure. And for some surgeons, it also limits the operating time because we facilitate multiple entries and exits. But the rest of the benefits up to now are absolutely not demonstrated. So the message is actually the use of ureteral access sheath should not be something systematic. You need to know why you are using an ureteral access sheath. And the main advantage actually is to maintain low intrarenal pressure. When do we need to do that? If it's an infected stone, you need to produce low pressure. So if you know that the stone is infected, you should use an ureteral access sheath. And if it's a long time, if you will stay a long time into the kidney, also to decrease the septic problem, we also recommend to use it. But if the stone is not too big, if it's not infected, There is no obligation actually to use an access sheet. You can do the procedure without. Think about rigid ureteroscope. When you do rigid ureteroscope, you are not using an ureteral access sheet. So this is the same concept. Using ureteral access sheet, you need also to be sure that you are using the good one regarding you and the scopes. So you need to know this correspondence between the type of the endoscope you are using and the size of the ureteral access sheet. If you are using the very small one actually, the 9.5 from Cook Medical, only 3 scopes actually fit with this small access sheet. But also keep in mind that if you are using this small scope in this really small access sheet, at the end, you have a very small residual space between the sheath and the scope, meaning that the backflow is really minimal. So you increase the pressure if you combine these 3 scopes with this access sheath. Today, in terms of compromise, it means using an access sheath not too big, but not too small, according to the scopes. The 10-12 French access sheath from the different companies are actually the best recommendation. Of course, if you're using big access sheath systematically, the 12-14, and if you force the placement, you will generate this type of problem. In total, it's more or less 50% of the ureter will be damaged by placing big access sheath and by forcing. So again, 2 messages, very simple. Never force and try to use as small as possible according to your endoscope. So regarding the access sheath actually, 4 take-home messages. The first one, it should not be a systematic step in your technique. If you use it, you need to have a good reason to use it. Never force to respect the ureter as small as possible, according to the pressure, according to the endoscope. And we also recommend to stay below the UPJ. Why? Because the UPJ is the most fragile part of the ureter. So if you place a big instrument in the UPJ, there's a big risk to damage the UPJ. And the second point, if you place the access sheath into the pelvis, it's a rigid instrument, so when you will flex the endoscope to go in the lower pole, you will force the endoscope against the ureteral access sheath, and you will damage the endoscope. So to preserve the ureter and to preserve the ureteroscope, we prefer to stay just below the UPJ. Regarding the laser, Holmium YAG laser is actually the gold standard. Even in India, you start to use the thulium fiber, and we will discuss tomorrow regarding the thulium fiber, a very interesting new laser. But until now, Holmium YAG is still the gold standard because we can treat everything into the collecting system. Any kind of stones, urothelial tumor, we can incise stenosis, we can also do small coagulations. The lasers actually exist between 15 to 120 watts. The question is, do we need high power system to treat stones? For prostate, we need high power. But what about the stones? In terms of parameters, settings, we also need to understand how it works. As you know, we have the energy, could be low energy, high energy. In joules, the frequency could be low frequency, few pulses per second, or high frequency, many pulses per second. And the pulse duration. Each pulse could be short, could be long. So we have 3 parameters, and we need to combine the parameters for the good setting. And you need to learn and to know what you have to do. If the machine you are using, if you can fix the pulse duration, most of the machines, actually, we can do that. This is the first
parameter that you have to fix. You start with the pulse duration. And you need to tell the machine if you would like short or long pulses. This is the first. So the question is, when do I need short? When do I need long? And the answer is relatively simple. For the short pulses, it's mainly for fragmentation. It means you would like to produce pieces and to basket the pieces, you select short. If you would like to do something different, dusting, to decrease retropulsion, to do the popcorn technique, to incise, to treat tumor and to coagulate, this is long. So you see, it's very simple. If you remember that the short pulse is fragmentation. For the rest, it's long. Then you move to the second parameter. And the second parameter is the energy in joules. And you need to know if you need low energy or high energy. For dusting, you need low energy. For fragmentation, you need high energy. If you would like to incise, you need high energy. If you would like to treat urothelial tumor or to coagulate, you need medium in between, medium energy. And you conclude all the time by the frequency. And just keep in mind that frequency is just to go fast or to go slow. So if you would like to be very precise, not to damage the mucosa, you decrease the frequency. Few pulses, but be sure that all the pulses are going to the stone and not the mucosa. If you are very comfortable, you are into the kidney and it's going very well, you would like to accelerate, just push the frequency as much as you can maintain. It could be 20, could be 40, 60, it depends on you. I can just tell you, most of the time, if you maintain the laser on, if you press the pedal, it's really difficult to maintain completely the pedal if you are using more than 30 Hertz. So, to summarize, do we need or not high power system, high power laser, to have the possibility to use this very high frequency? The answer is no. There's no need actually to treat stones to use this high frequency system. That's what we recommend in general, at least to start. But don't forget that these dusting parameters is just to start. You need to make a test. And if you are not happy, if it doesn't work very well, and we have seen this morning, you have to increase energy or to decrease energy. You adapt the energy until you are happy, and then you can proceed. Dusting, fragmentation, we cannot recommend to do only dusting, only fragmentation. You need to know both techniques, both settings, and you need to adapt. And most of the time you will start with the dusting, you will proceed with maybe dusting, maybe fragmentation, or popcorn. So you need to know these different techniques. We also said this morning regarding the volume of the stone, never forget that when you treat a stone of 1 centimeter compared to a stone of 2 centimeter, you multiply the diameter by 2, but don't forget that the volume increased by 8. It's an equivalent of 8 pieces of 1. This is not the same story. And if you move to a stone of 3 centimeters, it's not really the guidelines, but if you do that, you multiply the volume by 27. So be careful of that. Regarding the volume, there's also a comment, actually a general comment, that if you look at this stone is 2 centimeters. A little bit more. So if you look at the guidelines, you will say more than 2, I'm supposed to go for PCNL. But if you look really at the stone is 2 by 1. So if you calculate the volume of this stone, which is 2 by 1 by 1, and then you divide by 2, it means 1 cubic centimeter. And 1 cubic centimeter is an equivalent of 2 stones of 1 centimeter. So it's not really a stone of 2 centimeters. So the message is, don't consider the largest diameter, consider the volume of the stone. And it's easy to calculate the volume on the CT scan. How to evaluate the size of the fragments? When you are into the kidney, you have plenty of fragments and you would like to know if they are small enough or still too big. You can use the laser fiber. But remember that when we are using a fiber 270, it's inside. The blue part of the fiber is almost the double. So it means 400, 0.4 millimeters. You can also use the wire. We said the wire that you are using, it's approximately 1 millimeter of diameter. So you can compare the safety wire with the fragments. Of course, you can also use the X-ray, and you can compare on the X-ray the tip of the scalp with the fragments. Keep in mind, the tip of the scalp is 2.8, a little bit less than 3 millimeters. So what we said before, consider the volume, two centimeters for the largest diameter, but the volume is completely different. So don't be afraid sometimes to treat two centimeter stone because the volume is largely enough, less. If you are into the kidney, when you dust the stone, we recommend to start from the surface and to move to the center. So you keep one big piece and you reduce the size of the fragments. But if you are into the ureter, be careful. If you start from the surface, you will damage the mucosa. So into the ureter, using the laser, we recommend to start in front of you, go inside, and when you are inside, you move to the surface of the stone, from the center to the surface. Doing that, you preserve the mucosa. For the dusting, the trick is also not to touch the surface of the stone. You need to be very close. You need to respect a minimal distance and to move over the surface. Fiber size, with flexible ureteroscopes, the best compromise is fibers in the range of 200 microns, 200 to 270. You have exactly the same efficiency for the same settings compared to the big fibers, but you have more flexibility, more irrigation, and you produce less retropulsion. The small fiber push less the stones. To decrease the movement of the stone, as we said before, you need to use small fiber, but you need also to use less energy and select long pulse. If you're using big fiber, too much energy and short pulse, you will produce a lot of movements. The fiber, the laser fiber, damage during the treatment. And you damage the tip, especially when you treat hard stone, monohydrate, and if you select short pulse with high energy, it means that when you fragment, if you fragment monohydrate, you will damage very quickly the fiber. So what should you do? Regularly, during the treatment, we recommend to cut the tip, few millimeters. Lower pulse stone, as you know, it's a very challenging situation. If it's possible, we recommend to catch the stone with a basket and to relocate the stone in the upper pole. It's a very well-known recommendation. But sometimes, the stone is too big and you cannot catch it, otherwise you are blocked. So you need to decide if you treat the stone inside too, in the lower pole. So it means the endoscop completely flex into the lower pole. It's possible to do it, but be careful of the fiber. You cannot use a transparent tip when the scope is deflect. If you do this, you perforate. If you deflect the scope and you push the fiber, you will perforate. So we always recommend to straight the scope, pass the fiber when the scope is straight, and then you deflect to come back in the lower pole. You know that. It's very easy. And most of the time it works if you're using small fiber. But the problem is this situation. Sometimes you straight the scalp, you pass the fiber, and you deflect again, but unfortunately you cannot come back into the lower pole, and you cannot see the stone. So what can you do in this situation? It's possible to use specific laser fiber called ball tip. There's a ball at the tip, and because it's round, it's possible to stay completely deflect in the lower pole and to push the fiber. Because of the ball, you will not perforate. Problem is, when you activate the laser, the ball disappears. In few minutes, you have no more ball, and the fiber becomes a regular one. So it means also that you can only do one passage. You cannot pass the fiber multiple times when the scalp is deflagged. So what can you do if you don't have ball tip? There's a trick, and the trick is just to cut the transparent tip. You take regular scissors and you cut it. And when you cut, so it means the tip of the fiber is like this, only with the blue part, it's possible to stay deflect and to pass the fiber. So you reproduce exactly the same compared to the ball tip. And just to show you, into the working channel, we record the video. If I push the transparent tip, I perforate. But if I cut the transparent tip, you see that even the working channel is deflect, the fiber is going. Into the lower pole, that's what we recommend actually. Relocalize the stone if it's possible. Use single-use laser fiber if you are working inside too into the lower pole, small one. Cut the transparent tip, not too much energy, 0.5, and as soon as you can relocalize the fragments, do it. Cut the tip of the fiber, the transparent tip, we don't need it. Stone ablation, we need baskets to do that. I cannot tell you that one basket is superior to another one. The only thing that we recommend is to use baskets less than 2 French, small enough to go in a deflecting endoscopes. You can also use the clots. The clots are very useful because it plays the same role than glue, and because the fragments are glued into the clots, by removing the clots, you will be able to remove very small, tiny fragments. A small trick also to do by yourself, to introduce the instruments. If you make this position of your right hand, you fix it in between 2 fingers, and it's really easy to manipulate. There's no need to have an assistant to do that. Okay. When do we need to drain the patient after the surgery? As you know, the guidelines, the American and the European one, they are relatively easy to understand, saying that if it's uncomplicated, no complication, no double G. The problem is, what is the exact definition of uncomplicated? It's regularly difficult to know if we have to place a stent or not. I would just recommend, if you have any doubt, you can place a double G just for a few days. You can sometimes keep the string to remove after a few days the double G. Yeah. So if you have any doubt, drain the patient. Laser incision, that's what we recommend in terms of settings. To incise, you need to select long pulse, as we said, energy 1.2, 1.5, sometimes more, and use the frequency as high as possible. And then you need to know where you have to incise. And this is again anatomy. You have to come back to the anatomy. So again, you consider the patient in front of us, the right and the left kidney. If you would like to perform an endopilotomy to incise the UPJ because of a UPJ obstruction, a patient who failed after pyloplasty, robotic lap open. So it's a secondary UPJ obstruction. If it's in the right kidney, we recommend to cut at 7 o'clock on the screen. If it's the left kidney, you cut at 5. The only problem is this situation. We are using a digital endoscope, which is a fantastic endoscope. The view is beautiful, as you can see. But a digital endoscope is a fixed camera. It's not pendular. So if we are using a fixed system, you are completely disoriented. You are lost. You don't know where is the top and where is the floor. And look at this example. This is a right UPG obstruction. You see the stenosis, the safety wire is in place. If you consider it's the right, you are supposed to incise at 7 o'clock. So it means somewhere, 7 o'clock. But look at this, there's something wrong. Look at these bubbles. Why the bubbles are on the floor? Is it possible to have bubbles on the floor? Never. Have you seen before bubbles in between the ureteral orifices in the bladder? No. When you see bubble in the bladder, they are always on the top. So it's the same into the kidney. If you consider that the bubble are on the top, it means it's 12 o'clock. So if you recalculate, 7 o'clock is in fact 2 o'clock. It's like the jet lag. So you need to consider the exact positions. Be careful of that. If you have to incise the proximal ureter, it's like the UPJ, 7 and 5. So it's exactly the same. When you are in contact with the iliac vessels, you have to incise at 12 o'clock, both sides, the right and the left. If you are below, in between the iliac vessels and the ureteral orifice, you incise at 2 o'clock on the right and 10 o'clock on the left. And if you need to incise the ureteral orifice, as you know, 12 o'clock. So remember that when you are making incisions of ureteral stenosis, you cannot incise where you would like. You need to know where you are. You need to know the anatomy. If the stone is blocked, you catch some stones into the kidney and you try to remove and you are blocked into the ureter. Remember that if you are using baskets, as we said before, less than 2 French, in the working channel, you have still a lot of space. The working channel is 3.6 French. If you are using a 2 French basket, you can still place just in the same working channel, you can place a laser fiber. And then that's the situation. I'm blocked with the basket, and you recognize the stone. It's a cystine stone, typical one, don't miss it. You open the basket, and in the same channel, you can pass a laser fiber. And just by moving a little bit the endoscope, the laser fiber will move independently of the basket. You can fragment the stone into the basket, release the basket, and proceed with the fragmentation. Horseshoe kidney, again, a very challenging situation. It's a good indication for flexible ureteroscopy. You need to know that the ureter are relatively narrow, so sometimes you will have to pre-stent. It's very difficult to do the flexible ureteroscopy sometime. And in terms of manipulation, I would like also to re-explain this. Look at the left kidney. If you consider the lower pole, it looks like a normal left upper pole. It means that the calyces are coming from 3 o'clock. So if you remember that, what we mentioned initially, when you are working with the flexible scope into the upper pole, it's like a normal one. So you will rotate in prone. But look at the lower pole. The lower pole, if you look the direction of the calyces, it's like a normal right kidney, meaning that to engage the calyces, you will have to manipulate in supine position. So for the horseshoe kidney, you need both movements. Calyceal diverticulum, I don't know if this morning you used this trick, but you can use the methylene blue trick that you instillate through the working channel to inflate the calyceal diverticulum, and then you are looking for the leakage of the blue. If you have incrusted stent, it's also good to know that you can go alongside with your flexible ureteroscope, and when you are blocked, remember that laser is a light, and light is able to cut the double G. So you can cut the double G piece by piece and remove completely the double G retrogradely. Usually we need to cut below the iliac vessels and below the UPJ, 2 times. If you have a difficult situation with an ileal conduit, very difficult to come from below, remember that you can use a ureteral access sheath to replace the emplatz, and you go integrally through the kidney. Big stones, it was demonstrated and confirmed by Grasso, Bagley, that it was feasible with flexible ureteroscope, but you need to be honest and tell the patient that probably you will need 2 sessions. Don't tell the patient you will do it in 1 session. You need, again, to be honest. Combined treatment for very complex stones, you know the combination, the ACLS technique, something very useful. In the future, maybe we will also discuss the combination of shockwave lithotripsy together with flexible ureteroscopy. It's a nice combination. We need specific equipment to do that, but maybe we will. For the urothelial tumor, excellent indication for flexible ureteroscopy. Just keep in mind that this is a good indication if it's a unique tumor, less than 2 and low grade. And this is, I think, the most important recommendation, low grade. Don't do this procedure if it's a high grade tumor. And then it's very useful. You can go and follow me if you want on Twitter, if you want to see a little bit more tips and tricks. I would like to thank you really for your attention. And I can just recommend you also maybe to join the Endo Society in Abu Dhabi in November for the World Congress. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Traxler, for an exhaustive overview of treatment of renal stone disease, particular reference to flexible URS, and very exhaustively treated this, and we learned a lot of things from this. But I have two observations. You are talking about the guidelines, renal stone disease treatment, in both American and European guidelines. You have traveled all over India. You have operated in most of the places. The problem in the Indian population is they want any treatment in one sitting. It should be 100% successful. So we cannot follow the European or American guidelines. We have to adjust according to the local situation many times. Like many times, you would like to remove the stone by flexi URS, but you may leave behind a few stones, 4 millimeter stones, that is not acceptable to them. So immediately they say, you have not done the operation properly, so give back the money. That's the problem. And I have another observation is the scope, logic, American logic or a European anti-logic. All I want to say is that whatever you use the same scope. Don't change interchange, then you will be in trouble. And the third is the question, DJ stenting, pre-stenting this patient before doing the thing, how long you keep the stent? 1 week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks? Do you have any definite statements to say on that?
Okay, so just few comments. For the pre-stenting, I think we know actually coming from animal studies that if we keep the double G few days, 4 to 5, we obtain the maximum in terms of ureteral dilatation. I would say in clinical practice, actually, we leave the double G for 1 week, so a little bit more, 7, 8 days, and most of the time it's largely enough. So I would say, I would recommend more than 1 week, but less than 2 for sure, maybe 7 to 10 days. Some years ago, people were leaving the double G for a few weeks, 3, 4 weeks. Yeah. Of course, it works, but it's probably too much, and the patient, they don't really tolerate the double G, as we know. So if we would like to do a minimally invasive surgery by pre-stenting patient for a long time, I'm not so sure at the end it's minimally invasive. So
okay,
as short as possible, a week is enough. And you know, regarding also my second comment regarding the European and the American mode, you said that the American is logic and the European are anti-logic. You know, and it's funny because in Europe we say the European are logic, but the American are anti-logic. Okay? And I will just tell you why. You know, the American, as you know, when you deflect down, the system is going down. And when you deflect up, it's going up. So it seems logic. But the European, we say, no, the logic is when I deflect down, it should go up. And why? Because it comes from rigid cystoscope. You know, when you have a rigid cystoscope, you put the cystoscope into the bladder. When you would like to see, or up, okay, in the bladder to see the bubbles, what do? In your hand, you go down. And when you go down, you go up. And you know, when Olympus designed flexible scopes initially, they were thinking what the urologist will do intuitively to see up, they will probably do this movement, like a rigid cystoscope. okay, going down. And that's why they deflect down to go up. Okay. That's the story of this.
Thank
ontologic
you.
Or logic, it's up to you.
Huh?
I think the good message is it makes no difference actually to use the European, the American. As you said, don't change.
Yeah.
All the time use the same type. That's yes. true.
Exactly.
Thank you very much, sir.
I think only one question.
One question, sir.
Short of time.
For infundibular stenosis, which o'clock you would like to incise, in which calyx?
You know, if you ask the anatomist, you go to the anatomist and you will ask them, and they will say, be careful because the vessels are supposed to come at 3 and 9 o'clock. So it would be better probably to incise 12 and 6. So, okay, it's nice. But when you are into the system, to know exactly where it's 3 and 9 o'clock, it's impossible. So what we recommend actually, you incise where you can, because it's difficult. So you incise where you can incise, but don't go too deep. So it means don't make only one incision going deep into the parenchyma. We prefer to use the star mode technique. It means that you incise a little bit at 3 o'clock, a little bit at 9, maybe a little bit at 6 and 12. And doing this, you open just what you need to go in. I don't believe that people saying, okay, you need to make a large incision to keep the infundibulum open at the end. It doesn't work. In my experience, I went a second time into the kidney for such patients, and I can tell you that all the time, it's again a stenosis. The stenosis is coming back. So I would say incise just what you need. The tip of the endoscope is 2.8 millimeter, so there's no need to make large incision. Just do what you need to go in, to treat the stone, to clean the stone, to flush the fragments, and that's it. But there's no need to go too deep at the end.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Professor.